Hello, and welcome to Remove Film from Tray, episode 19. We're back. Little midweek, little off-schedule episode, little treat. I'm X Mortis. You can call me Mortis. Count's here.
Hey. It's October.
Finally.
Halloween time.
Slushy's here.
I hate October.
What?
I just don't like horror movies. I don't like horror. It's scary.
Bleh.
I'm a scaredy cat.
You some kind of fucking pussy, Slushy?
Things you wish you knew. Go to things you wished you knew before gaming Reddit to find out Slushy hates horror.
What?
You never been there? You never been to that Reddit? It's like,
no.
Like I wish I knew in Metal Gear Solid 3 that you could shoot the beehive on that one part. I don't know, shit like that.
Well, that person's a dumbass because Naked Snake looks at the beehive and does the smile that has been memed to death. So if he didn't think to try and shoot it down, then he just wasn't paying attention. He probably thinks that game's not political.
It's not.
No? So here's something that's not political.
Mm-hmm.
It was the Avengers. Was this political? I don't know. Was this anything?
We don't know what this is. I screened the Avengers. For those of you listening, audio only, available on such platforms as Google Podcast and Apple Podcast. This is the...
And Spotify.
And Spotify.
Definitely this is Spotify. I upload them to Spotify. They're supposed to automatically go to the other things, but nobody will tell me if they're there. And I can't look myself.
Well, it's on Google Podcast. It's not a closed system like Apple Podcasts.
Spotify listeners, special shout out to you. This is the Avengers, though, not the comic book movie, but the 1998 adaptation of the 1960s television show. And it is a mess of a fucking movie. But not as bad as being the worst movie of all time. Like, it gets
a reputation. What was the citation for that on Wikipedia?
I don't know, but I also remember when this came out, people were saying it, like, years ago.
I don't remember hearing anything about it. I remember Cyraptor, friend of the show, was saying that he remembers a standee of the movie. Like, I remember that, too. I remember this being, like, pushed. But, I mean, I also remember, like, a cardboard standee of Wind Talkers or whatever, so...
If you don't know what the Avengers
of any
are... Originally, folks, it's a secret agent show, spies, British dandies with a hot girl usually teaming up. It's not always Emma Peel, but that's the most famous one, is Emma Peel. And it's kind of like Doctor Who, where you have this guy and he always has a babe following around helping with shit. And usually the woman is more competent than he is. And that guy's name is Steed, although I think in the first series, because they don't call things seasons over there because the British are insane. In series one, it's like just two dudes. So just skip to series two if you're in it for the babes. If you're in it for the two dudes, just stop after season one. Anyway, this movie has Emma, like, it's an adaptation. It's its own take on the series, and it brings up back Emma Peel, this time played by Uma Thurman, and Ralph Fiennes playing Steed. And Uma Thurman's being cloned, and her clone is doing all these atrocities in her name, and Emma Peel is set to be some badass, but we don't see any of that. We're just told it.
We
don't see any of it.
By the movie? Because I had never... I like, when this came out, I remember being like, what? What, Avengers? All right, well, kind of take your word on that. I had still never seen an episode until Count showed me one right before we watched this movie, and Emma Peel is highly competent and, like, fighting a lot and acrobatic, and in this movie Uma Thurman does nothing. Like, she gets knocked out about four times and she does nothing. Like, I don't, and she, like, she's a doctor, I remember them making a big deal about that. I don't, like, she's, what is she, a botanist or something? I don't even remember what was, like, going on. Why did they bring her in?
She, like, was leading the project that Sean Connery's character stole to manipulate the
world. Oh, okay.
That right, Sean Connery's in this too. He's the villain, and he's like doing an impression of himself, and it sucks.
The thing about this film is that I think they expect people watching it to be fans of the show, which
Americans didn't know what it was.
Yeah,
Americans didn't know what it was, and also this came out like 20 to 30 years after show was.
I mean, that's, you know, there was a lot of that going around. We had the...
For sure. Like Charlie's Angels shortly after this. And
what's that other one? Brady Bunch.
Right.
Was there a Brady Bunch movie?
There were like two.
In the 90s, yeah.
Weren't there?
Wow.
Yeah, there were two. At least.
Dukes of Hazzard, you know. A lot of...
And a lot of those were revivals. Rerun to death on American television in syndication. And
right.
The Avengers did run... in syndication in America, but not until I was in college. That's which is when I watched it. It was right before the comic book Avengers came out.
I remember Starsky watching and it. Hutch is another one.
Yeah.
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 Which I did see. And I remember liking.
Yeah, they were probably not very good. They were looking for fodder for big Hollywood movies. Wild Wild West was
that based on a show?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Anyway. It didn't feel faithful to the show. Mainly because of Uma Thurman. I don't know. A lot of the people we were watching this with was like, Uma Thurman. Damn, I'll watch anything with Uma Thurman. Where does that come from? I don't know.
It comes from
Kill Bill.
Kill Bill Pulp Fiction thing.
Yeah. Like, what else besides Kill Bill and Pulp Fiction has she been in? Because I can't...
Probably a lot of stuff.
I'm sure, yeah. I just can't necessarily think of anything. At least in the
she's
era.
She's been in things.
Oh, yeah. I guess she was in Batman and Robin.
Yeah, there you go.
Which people also hate and consider to be one of the worst films of all time, but they're incredibly wrong.
She also plays a plant doctor in that.
Maybe that's why I thought she was a plant. I thought Steed was cool.
Yeah.
Slushie hated him.
Yeah, he always seemed like he was on the verge of tears.
What? I mean, stiff upper lip and all that, right?
His face acting, like, it was really weird, and I don't know if Ralph Fiennes is just like that. Because I don't think I've really seen any other Ralph Fiennes films.
Apparently he plays Voldemort, if that means anything to anyone.
He doesn't have a nose in that. Like
he's like
it's
CG.
It's a completely different situation.
Anyway, his nose in this sucks. bad nose acting. So maybe that's why they took it off.
Here's some other things Uma Thurman's been in. Nausicaa of the Valley of the Wind in 1984. So probably not Nausicaa.
The Disney
probably
one.
Whatever that. Yeah.
It says 1984 because that's when it came out. But it's the Disney one.
Okay, that makes sense.
I think she might be
Adventures.
Kushinada.
She's Kushana. Right. Adventures of Baron Munchausen. A bunch of movies I've never heard of. And then Pulp Fiction. And then more movies I've never heard of. And then Batman and Robin. And
I don't like Pulp Fiction.
And 98 Les Mis.
No.
And The Avengers.
I don't love it.
And then a bunch of movies I've never heard of.
I should say I don't hate it, but yeah, I don't love it. People talk about it too much as if it's the best fucking thing in the world.
Well, it's...
Watch more movies.
It's revitalized... Some would say vitalized to begin with in indie film.
Yeah, well, it ruined search engine optimization for real actual Pulp Fiction, and I will never forgive it for that.
And then he did it again with Grindhouse, fucker.
He did it again. You fucker. Stop it.
What's he going to do next? I don't even know. He's just going to make a movie called Pornography.
She's in My Super Ex-Girlfriend. I forgot about that movie.
She plays the super.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. What, you know, why does she suck in this? Is it Hollywood's fault? Is it the director's
fault? Supposedly this was gutted. People in my chat were saying that it was gutted, and I thought they were all joking, but they're actually, it was much longer, and they cut out about an hour from the runtime.
According to Wikipedia,
like an hour of cool action scenes?
I don't know.
Because normally when shit is cut from a movie, it's like, oh, that was, I see why that was cut. Like, it's not like,
right,
oh, this cool high budget like lady flipping and kicking scene. Like, oh, we don't need that.
I suggest watching the original show over this because Emma Peel is competent and cool and sexy and funny and flirty, and it's very easily available. It's on Pluto TV. It's also on the Internet Archive. Check it out, the original Avengers. This was on Tubi.
This is not the worst movie of all time.
Right.
Not even close, but it's not very good. And
yeah,
it's not really all that interesting.
Kind of boring.
Yeah.
It has a lot of like highfalutin. I said this while we were watching. Sorry, Slushy. Slushy was like mad about how British this movie was. And like, I feel like this movie, I said while we were watching, I feel like this is an MTV executive's idea of what British is. Like, right. It's just like, yeah, just bare style, like zero substance, posh. Like every scene is in a new kind of goofy room. Like, there's just like a lot of weird accent and eccentricity to it that like they don't really go into. Like, it's all the weird stuff is like in one scene and then it's gone, and they don't really play into it that much. I don't know. It's just not a great movie.
Right. And Mortis was asking me if the old show was as sci-fi as this movie is. And I don't remember it being sci-fi. I remember there was an episode of Robots, but I looked it up on the Wikipedia, and as the series went on, it went more and more sci-fi and weird, apparently, which I guess this movie is taking from. But once again, I didn't watch the original show until way after this movie, about 10 years. But for the sake of argument, had it been in syndication and someone like myself only seen those early episodes, this would be like, what the fuck? What the fuck is this? This isn't the fucking Avengers. What is going on? When half your show is played straight as a sci-fi or as a straight spy serial, and then it turns into sci-fi in the later half. That's weird.
Pretty weird.
Don't check it out. Check out the original series.
I don't think it deserves the 5% it has on Rotten Tomatoes, but I don't think it deserves that much higher.
I agree.
Yeah.
Maybe a 30%.
I mean, you know, keep in mind, it's an aggregate of thumbs up or thumbs down. It's not like people giving it a 5. I think in that regard, like, who is going to give this a thumbs up? I don't know, but
right.
It has a 3.8 on IMDb. I'd say that's more accurate.
Yeah. I think that's, I gave it a fitting 3. So that's a
couple
the
other
Avengers.
Harry Potter actors in this too.
Not great. Let's see. Count.
Oh, before we move on,
yeah,
what I did want to say when you so rudely interrupted, okay, I don't. There is a novelization.
Go on.
Of the film, apparently, that used the original script. So if you want to know what got cut, read the book.
Thank you, Slushy. You see that a lot. That's interesting. I don't know.
Yeah, it's really weird how many like novelizations of films there are in general. Like it kind of makes sense for like movies aimed at younger audiences, I think.
Yeah.
Because like, oh, here's a movie you like. Do you want to read a book about it?
I remember
like,
reading
my
a lot
kid,
of novelizations.
My kid's finally fucking reading. Yeah, right, yeah.
In like sixth but grade, like, yeah.
For the Avengers, that's weird.
Yeah. I follow a guy on YouTube, The Dungeon Dive, and then he has this spinoff channel. and he like collects novelizations of movies. He's always like remarking on the differences. The
novelization of Fellowship of the Ring.
Ah, what if that happened?
I'm sure something like that exists at some point where it's like an adaptation novelization.
A novelization of the Ralph Bakshi animated version. I don't know. So, Count, you've seen some movies.
I did.
That we didn't watch
movies without you. I'm sitting here. I'm sipping my coffee, watching movies. One of them was Jim Jarmusch's Only Lovers Left Alive, which is a film starring Tom Hiddleston and Tilda Swinton as ancient vampire lovers. At the beginning of the movie, they're in two different parts of the world, and they slowly come together. Not that slowly. About a half hour in, they meet up. And it's a hangout movie. Not a lot happens. And I loved it. I have seen a few Jim Jarmusch movies. Some of them I hate, such as that fucking zombie movie he made. I thought it was atrocious. But
the one with Kylo Ren?
Yes. Which I... Dead Don't Die, I think it's what it's called.
Yeah.
I saw a screening of that like fucking 2 weeks earlier than it came out. And it was funny because there were people outside of the theater and they wanted your opinions, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they could hear me. They could hear us all that fucking
They could hear
sucked.
You cussing.
So, right. So they're asking everyone in front of me because they're like, oh, yeah, this is really nice. And they don't ask me like for like a statement or anything. So that's my anecdote about Jim Jarmusch. But Only Lovers Left Alive is really good. I think it's from 2010-ish. No, 2012, maybe? I didn't look it up. About 10 years old.
Okay.
It's pretty comfy. It's not a horror movie at all. It's just these vampires suffering from ennui. Aesthetically, it's incredible. She's obsessed with books, and he's obsessed with music, so his whole house is like an ancient mansion in a rotting Detroit. There's a lot of on-location shots of Detroit. And so his mansion is filled with instruments and records and old recording equipment. So if you're into something that's just chill and calm and romantic, because it has vampires, it's going to be romantic, I would check this out. Don't expect something fast-paced. Don't expect action. Just because it's vampires. Like, them being vampires is almost secondary completely to the plot. Like, it comes in, and there's some quirky stuff with it, but it's very much just like a movie about two people in love who came back together and are trying to, like, rekindle their love.
That sounds all right.
Jim Jarmusch looks a little bit like a Bogdanov twin.
There,
I don't know.
There's
what
a few
is.
Things in this movie I could see people rolling their eyes at, which I don't know. I don't know. If you don't want the movie to be spoiled, skip ahead a minute or two until this is off the screen. And Morrison Slushy, I hope you don't mind me spoiling it for the two of you. But now, I don't mind this so much because, you know, I'm clearly a Count. I deal with vampire stories and lore. But I can see how some people will get upset with shit where it's like they're ancient vampires. There's another guy who's played by John Hurt. He's a vampire. And it's like, oh, he was actually Shakespeare. And then, like, Tom Hiddleston's character was actually all these famous musicians. Like, that type of thing.
Yeah.
Which a lot of people would roll their eyes at. So if you don't like little cutesy things like that, it's a very small part of the movie. Get over it. That's all.
Like a Captain Raz aside here, just creating a straw man to yell at it.
Yeah, well, because I know people would be upset. They'd be like, oh, he's supposed to be Shakespeare? Is this corny? It's about vampires, okay? What happened to fun? As Slushy always says.
Yeah.
What did happen to fun?
What the fuck happened to fun?
Happened have to some fun.
Go watch Legend of Chun-Li. It's fun.
We're going to.
Yeah.
We're going to be doing an episode in the future. We don't know when. It's going to be called Let's Kill Count, and we're going to watch all Slushy's movies that she wants to show me. I'm announcing it formally.
Well, now we have to do it.
Oh, we're going to do it.
Can we just get it over with?
Yes.
So probably I don't have to hear about it anymore. So you make it through October, Slushy, then we'll give you this.
All right, we all gotta get it settled in November, and then we'll do it.
All right, so another Count movie, The Love Witch. Is this really an old movie, or is this like a fake old movie?
This is a fake old movie.
Oh wow, it looked pretty authentic.
It's also, let me look up the date.
2016.
2016. Thank you, Slushy. It is from 2016. Yeah. It's shot to look like it's from the 60s, kind of like a Hammer horror movie, but kind of also just like an American 60s horror movie. It's set in America. It's set in modern time, although they're all wearing 60s style clothes. They're driving modern cars and they have smartphones. So it's a very weird, timeless type of movie.
Yeah.
Streets of Fire.
Yeah.
We don't really know what the time period is, and it doesn't really matter. You're in just for the ride. It's a very pretty movie. The main woman, the Love Witch herself, is constantly changing outfits, and she looks gorgeous in all of them. And what it's about is a woman had her heart broken, so now she's on a revenge path against all men, where she gets a man to fall in love with her, and then she ends up killing him. And she's a bit insane, and the movie follows her, essentially, just seducing men, killing men. And even the cop that tries to get on her trail, she ends up seducing. And who knows what happens between the two of them? I won't spoil this one.
You ever see Under the Skin?
I have seen Under the Skin. With ScarJo.
She takes her top off in that.
She does more. She takes everything off in that.
Yeah.
You see everything. I don't remember if there's nudity in this.
There's guarantee nudity in this.
There's nudity in the trailer on IMDb.
I don't think you see her breasts, though. I think she just like takes off her clothes and then you don't actually see anything.
Well, yeah, she's got like the long hair that go in front of her boobs, yeah. But she's fully nude.
Well, that's not nudity then. It's a,
right. If you don't, there's no nip.
You gotta, yeah.
There's no nip. But if you're into Hammer horror movies like I am, it has a bit of that flair to it. This is on Tubi, I believe, or was.
At least a few days ago.
Yeah. Although I think we watched it on some other service, but it is on Tubi. I recommend The Love Witch. It's also another slow movie. It's not a lot of action. It's not a lot of crazy horror kills. It's just kind of another hangout movie with this really insane witch. And if you like colors, I'm colorblind, so imagine if you could see colors. You would love this movie. I can't even see most of them, and I liked it. So I think it's worth watching. If you're into this sort of thing, if you're into Hammer horror, if you're into old satanic panic type movies, check out The Love Witch. It's pretty good.
All right.
What kind of colorblind are you?
Reds and greens, also blues.
So what does that mean?
Browns are in that too.
Reds and greens look the same to you?
Yeah, reds, green, and brown. They look the same. They say colorblind. It's more like I'm color stupid.
Right.
I don't know why they say colorblind. It should be like some sort of color dyslexia almost.
If they called people colored stupid, I think it would not be well regarded as a term.
Sure, but then people think I can't see the color at all. It's just that like
there's just like a hole in it. I can just see through it.
Growing up, we'd be like, well, what's this color? It's like, they look the same. Like, what do you want me to say? I can see a color. There's something there. Anyway,
I'm sorry for your loss. So
Autumn, the leaves are changing. Go see them.
Yeah.
IMDb showed Shadow Creature as his Friday night movie. This is a little B movie about a hair product that turns a man into a crazy shadow creature. He goes on a rampage, killing up people at the local college, which also is a laboratory, but also has a lot of theater kids. So yeah. This movie has great effects, really good kills, kind of a shitty story, kind of boring outside of the kills and effects, but for what it is, it's also neat. And I could recommend Shattered Creature.
We watched that other short film where Luke Skywalker killed people at the local community
college.
We did.
This was better than that.
Okay.
This is practical effects. There's intestines. There's kind of the Vampire Hunter D thing where this guy has a hole in his hand and it's pulsing at him. And it's.
Does it talk to him?
It doesn't talk to him, but it's pretty fucking gnarly. There's some good shit in this. And then a lot of boring shit like a B-movie has from the era. It's a shame because if this had a little bit of a higher budget and a tighter script, this could be a real fucking classic. MDB was showing on stream, like, because it was on YouTube, and then the comments are like, I'm so glad my grandfather made this movie. Like, my dad worked on this movie, so apparently big fans of the movie all worked on the movie or had someone work on the movie, which I think is cute and nice, and it's a good movie. If this is the only thing that guy made, it's a nice legacy for anyone to have worked
on. I'm looking at the poster here, and I'm not recognizing really any of these names.
Yeah, it's a true little indie picture.
Yeah.
But I think it's worth watching. Like I said, it's not the stuff outside of the effects. Kind of boring. Acting, not that great. But for what it is... The Shattered Creature runs, and it's the funniest shit. And it's so he's kind of like the wolf man, but he's like a fish man, so he has like his pants and shirt on still, but he's like kind of this fish creature. I liked it. I like Shattered Creature. You can get it on YouTube for free. Go watch it. Good. This is a good one for all you college kids out there wanting to show something a little bit rare. Shattered Creature.
Needs to be cooked a little more. It's a little, still a little pink in the middle.
A little pink. It could be Titan, could be better, but for people that seemingly have no industry connections and never went on to, I think it's good. Making movies hard.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll
that's easy.
I can say more about that later. So, back together again, the last of the minor movies of the week, Grosse Pointe Blank. We watched this last night, two nights ago, I don't remember.
Two nights ago.
This from 1998, is that right? Ish.
It's definitely set in 98.
Sure. I love this movie. Great movie. I'd seen it before.
97.
Count, you'd seen it before.
I had seen it before, and I do love this movie.
You didn't see it before.
Yeah.
Synopsis the movie, Slushy.
John Cusack, who deserves to be in more roles.
Let me jump
now
in.
And forever.
Okay. I was wondering about that because it does seem like he fell off, but like. He's still in a lot of stuff. It's just like stuff you've never heard of, and it has like 3 on IMDb. So he's still working. He's just not really, I think, of leading man age anymore. Is the issue. Anyway, go on.
He's a hitman. He's a professional killer. He will remind you of that every 3 minutes. Anytime he talks to someone, which is a very funny bit. And he's been invited to his high school reunion, where the girl that he stood up at prom lives in the city of Grosse Pointe, Michigan, very near to where I grew up, but I lived in the poor part of it. So I went to the area where this film was filmed once, and it was very walkable. There were like cobblestone streets. They were playing music over like a PA system in the entire town. It was insane.
It was an insane look into how the rich live. Very strange. Anyway, he goes to the reunion because he also has a contract in that town. And hijinks ensue because he's going a little crazy and he's not sure why. He meets up with the girl that he stood up on prom. And I don't want to get into too many specifics because I think it's a movie that someone should just watch. But it was very good. It was very fun.
Do you think... Go ahead, Mortis.
No, go on.
I was going to say, do you think he goes around even before the events of this film when he meets someone and just says, I'm a professional killer? Or do you think it was part of his mental breakdown?
I think it was part of his mental breakdown. I think...
Yeah,
I think he didn't say anything to anyone before the events of this film, right, and that was sort of part of the point.
One of the few people he ever talks to, it feels like, is his assistant.
Right.
And his therapist, who he has basically kidnapped.
Right. His therapist, who he's threatened the life of if he doesn't do therapy on him.
I think this movie has basically a perfect script, and most of the performances are really, really good. It's very quippy and very smart. Like, everything in it gets set up and paid off in really good ways. Just all the characters are fun and believable. I feel like I was thinking about this in the shower. I think the weakest part of the movie was the two CIA guys. With the exception of the scene in the bathroom, they just kind of sleepwalk through the movie, it feels like, which one of them is Hank Azaria. Is that right?
Right. That's
the
right.
Simpsons guy from Godzilla. Almost got stepped on by Godzilla. Dan Aykroyd's in this. He's great. He's incredible in this.
He's fantastic.
He's neurotic and on pills. He's the rival hitman.
If you love Ghostbusters and love Dan Aykroyd in Ghostbusters, you owe it to him and yourself to watch literally any other movie he's in, because he's fucking great in all of them that I've seen. Anyway, which is Nothing But Trouble, which is great. Neighbors, which is great. This, which is great.
Feeling very great proud night. Right now of my little slushy.
Thank you.
We love you, Dan. Your vodka's a little too expensive, but we love you.
I need to.
I've never seen Blues Brothers or Coneheads, but I'm sure he's great in those two.
I like Blues Brothers. Coneheads is his SNL movie, you know.
Yeah, I don't really like Coneheads. Blues Brothers is kind of SNL movie too, isn't it?
I mean, technically, it shows up on the lists, you know. Yeah. If there's a listicle about top 10 SNL movies, they'll put it on there.
Blues Brothers was made by that guy.
That guy?
No, I'm not kidding.
What? All right. Yeah, I don't know.
Tragedy.
What?
John Landis.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't think anyone died filming Blues Brothers, even though they drove through that mall, which seems pretty dangerous. But yeah, Grosse Pointe Blank. I don't know. I was watching a little shout out to another Twitch user, Forbidden VHS. I may not even have the name right. It was going through a stack of tapes and pulled out Grosse Pointe Blank and was like, hey, you don't hear about this movie anymore. This is a weird movie. It's like, I feel like this was pushed a lot at the time. Like, I remember going to Blockbuster and the poster was always staring me back in the face from in front of where I parked. But yeah, you don't really hear about this that much anymore. I don't know.
Yeah, people don't talk about this movie. It deserves it. Dan Aykroyd's performance is really good. All the performances are good.
Do people talk about rom-coms anymore?
Is this a rom-com? I guess it is.
It's a bit of rom-com.
I mean, it's...
It's a rom-com that a human can watch, you know, which
right,
I think is rare.
It's not a very formulaic rom-com,
right,
but I would say it's a rom-com. But yeah, I feel like I'm sure they're still being made. I don't talk to many
yeah, I don't know,
regular people anymore, I guess.
It like, feels very Shane Black guys, to me, but, this movie. You know,
could you explain what that means to the viewers?
To the viewers at home, listeners. Shane Black, who wrote Predator, directed The Predator, don't see that movie. He did Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. You should see that one. That one's good. He wrote The Monster Squad. He writes these tight scripts that are very funny and everything pays off. And that's what this feels like to me. Because this director has like a no career outside of this movie.
Yeah, very weird career on this director.
And this movie's fucking good. And so why didn't this person get more chances? Or what led to this? What made this so good? Was the director really... How much input did he have? I'm curious about all of that.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, the director has just a couple, like, really small, sort of, like, late era, you know, grindhouse, I guess, like shitty little action movies that no one has ever heard of, and then like this, and then nothing.
That's a shame, because if as much of this movie is reflected on the director, if that's true, then that he had a lot of potential to give us a lot more great movies in the 90s.
I knew how to direct actors, I guess.
Absolutely.
Good soundtrack, too. I don't know. It depends on how much you like The Clash, I guess.
I don't mind The Clash, so I enjoyed it.
I had a job that I only had for, like, 2 months one time that literally every day the soundtrack was on. Just always. So
soundtrack to this or just
to this? Clash? Yeah, this album. This is a big soundtrack movie. I don't know. Big soundtrack seller, I guess. I've heard it a lot. Don't love The Clash personally, but it's got Faith No More a little bit. It's got Pixies snuck in there. Who cares? Great movie.
The, stands Doom on its 2 own. Machine. Are we going to talk about that?
There's a Doom 2 arcade machine. Yeah. In this, Benny the Jet Urquidez is in this. Famous actor from scene ever. Best fight scene ever, if you're on YouTube. The story behind what? The arcade game?
The Doom cabinet.
Yeah, it's interesting. Because, like, I don't know. Why engineer a fake Doom 2 arcade cabinet for a film, for one, like, 2 scenes of a film.
Right, to be in the background.
Like,
some alternate world, I get that, I guess.
Yeah, it's kind of timeless, like Streets of Fire in that way.
I think I understand it, kind of. Because, like, it plays a big part in a gunfight that happens in the location where it is. Where they're like cutting back and forth between some dude on his headphones playing the Doom 2 arcade cabinet.
Oh yeah, Motorhead and also then, on the soundtrack. Speaking.
Yeah. And then 2 guys in the gas station where it is like shooting at each other.
Yeah, like, do you think they wanted
pretty funny
Lethal Enforcers? Like, what would have been out in 98 that they could have just 96. Had instead? 96
or 97? Sorry, it takes place in.
It's just weird, you know? Why make, you know? I mean,
I don't know. That guy looks like...
I think they could have had to be Lethal Enforcers, you know? And that might have made for a funny scene. You know? Just like a gun game instead of a FPS game. I don't know.
I agree. Strange choice, but... I wonder if the director was a big Doom fan or
somebody just, must have been. Yeah.
Yeah. When the set designers was, how'd they sneak that into the fucking movie?
It's just like, it's a whole thing. It has like a marquee.
Right. You know,
it's like a whole custom cabinet. But anyway,
like, did they make it for the movie? Did they must find have. That somewhere? What happened?
Yeah, I mean, maybe somebody had it, you know, maybe somebody on the staff just was like, oh, I got this. I love Doom 2 so much. I got this.
Found this at the pawn shop. Some sucker's getting a divorce, and he had to sell it for $50.
I, you know,
they could have gotten the Quake arcade machine.
That's pretty rare.
Galloping Ghost has the Doom 2 arcade machine from this movie, by the way.
Do they really?
No.
No, I'm lying.
They okay. do have the Quake.
They do have the Quake. Yeah, I was going to say.
Maybe it'll show up on a Monday mystery game.
Yeah, tune in later. We are doing this on Monday. Yeah, I don't know.
Early Bird Club.
Great film, smart film, fun film. You, if you're a man, you won't notice it's a romantic comedy, even if you've seen it like seven times.
This is only my second time seeing it. And I did pick up on more things, and it's very enjoyable, very tightly written. It's a good movie.
Highly recommend it. I've been thinking about making like a document or something, you know, to like keep track of what we've talked about and our rating, which we don't really necessarily give a rating. But I don't know.
Maybe could be something.
I'm thinking
there.
About starting a NeoCities. I got a NeoCities account. I'm going to make a web page again. Just
that would be cool.
Catherine Raz, cover your ears for the next 15 seconds. Grosse Pointe Blank is definitely a movie that would be good for college kids to show their other college friends because they've never fucking heard of it, and they will love it, and you're at the right age, and it's perfect.
Yes. I mean, that's when I saw it. So.
They could have used Egg Venture instead of Doom.
Did you just pick an arcade game?
I'm looking at... Well, it's an arcade game where you shoot at eggs with the light gun. And it was released in 97.
I'm not familiar. I'll have to look it up.
Neither was I. I posted a picture of it in the Discord.
Let's see. Let's look at this Egg Venture. Oh, this looks bad.
Yeah.
This looks cheap. Yeah, I mean, I can see why they maybe didn't use that. But
House of the Dead also came out that year, but like... That's zombies. Maybe that would have been weird.
Yeah. Anyway, our big movie of the episode, Streets of Fire.
Which I think we've talked about in every episode leading up to this one.
Just about.
Almost definitely. Sort of a running gag. From me anyway. I feel like
I love this.
I always
movie.
Mention it. I've moved this into my top 10. Ghostbusters, sorry, you're out. You're number 11 now. Shuffled things
Eat
around.
Shit, Ghostbusters, you're not that good.
Wow.
We were just praising Dan Aykroyd.
Yeah, come on. What are you doing?
Yeah, and I was just saying, hey, watch his other movies because they're way better.
Slushy doesn't like horror.
Right.
I don't hate...
Just a little joke.
I don't hate Ghostbusters. I just
it's over the like heart. That's
that special. Not
so. Streets of Fire. It's a rock and roll fable. Says on the poster. What is this guy's name? The director.
Walter Hill, right?
Walter Hill. Yeah. He did The Warriors, right? And then
he did.
What else has he done?
48 Hours. He wrote, he produced Aliens.
Oh, yeah. I'm a big, I don't know, 80s.
He did Tales from the Crypt.
What, like the movie? Or
I believe the TV show. He like helped make that.
Oh, interesting. This is a... I want to say the first thing that you see in this movie, it says another time, another place. Am I making that up?
That's right.
Okay. This is a movie that takes place. It's a Western, Slushy pointed out. It's a 80s movie. It's a 50s movie. It takes place in a timeless vacuum. If you, I think
it takes place in the 20th century.
Was it the first? I think the first time we mentioned this was fucking Curse of the Puppet Master.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that movie had a poor sense of place, ill-defined. This is just, you know, this is just, it's magical. You don't worry about it. Don't think about it. This is a
this takes place in the 20th century in an American city.
Yes.
That's all that matters.
And they never say the name of it. And you don't need to know it.
Oh, but we know it now.
We know it now.
Well, oh, boy, we know later. It now.
I mean, it looks like Chicago. It's got an elevated train. I don't know. Everyone has pompadours in the film. Most of the supporting characters, including the Wild Bill Paxton. Huge pompadour. What would you even call this? Like, I guess you would call it an action movie, right?
It's an action movie. It's a musical in a way.
Yeah.
It's
not a musical. I refuse to apply that term to this film.
Why?
Okay. I will.
Why do you refuse?
I'll use it positively.
Because musicals have, like, non-diegetic music, usually. In that everybody just starts singing it, which isn't what this movie does.
Right.
This movie, music is intrinsic to the film. The music of the film is intrinsic to the film and the story.
So you would say Cabaret isn't a musical because there's, when they do music in Cabaret, it's because they're singing in the cabaret. It's not.
I don't know anything about Cabaret.
Yeah, I'm just being a smartass.
I kind of figured, but like.
there's three big music scenes in this.
Yes, but like.
Maybe more.
They're not looking at the audience and singing.
Right. I know what you're saying. It's got music in it. Music is very important to it.
Right.
But it's not a musical. If you're worried about a musical, don't be worried about a musical with this movie. I don't know. I'm going to sneeze. Hang on. Somebody else say something.
Go ahead, Slushy.
No, what were you going to say?
I'm always cutting you off, so please, Slushy.
I think that this is one of the greatest films of all time, and it is obviously highly influential, but I don't understand why I didn't hear about it before I met Mortis.
Yeah, okay, so...
I guess because it was technically a box office failure.
Was it?
It cost $14.5 million, and it made $8.1 million.
Jesus. Yeah, I don't know, like, I never really heard of this, you know. I was alive when it came out. I was old enough to watch TV and see trailers, but I'd never heard of this until like the aughts, you know, and that was in the context of, hey, check out this movie that Final Fight is based on, which we'll talk more later on that. Yeah. But it's just weird. Like, it seems to... I feel like most of the people I know now know about Streets of Fire, and maybe that's just because of me. But I don't know. Where did you hear about this, Count?
Definitely from the Proto Men.
Right. More about that later as well.
So, it was probably around 2008 because the Proto Men put out their first album, which we'll get in more into that. But everyone would say, oh, it's based off this movie, Streets of Fire. And I was like, what's the Streets of Fire thing? So I tracked it down, a torrent of it, and watched it. And although actually, I might not have watched it until like 2009 because I remember watching it at a friend's house and it was after high school. So it would have been 2009. Loved it. We all loved it. It was fucking incredible and unlike anything we had ever seen or really seen since. You can't replicate this. If you made a sequel to this, it would be like the worst piece of shit in the world even trying. You can't even fucking attempt it. Don't do it.
Yeah, it'd be like making a sequel to like a fairy tale, you know? Like yeah. Cinderella 2. Like, no.
Just don't do it.
Can't do that.
Yeah, I didn't know this existed until the Proto Men put out their first album. I had no idea that this was a thing.
Weird.
I need the Warriors. I need Walter Hill.
Yeah, like Warriors has stayed in the, you know, cultural zeitgeist, right? Like, as long as I've been alive, I've been hearing people say, Warriors, come out and play. Like, why? Why that? Why not? I don't know. What's going on?
I like this version of Warriors.
You're going to watch Warriors soon.
Yeah.
And you'll understand.
But I mean, I'm sure it's fine, but
you're
it's
also
like,
correct.
It's a good movie.
It's just, why Warriors? Why is there a Warriors PS2 game? Why isn't there a Streets of Fire PS2 game?
Well, because they've been making Streets of Fire games since the movie came out.
Yeah, they've also
Warriors have all
Warriors
the different
games.
Things. It's like a whole thing and marketable and
yeah.
I don't know.
I don't. Okay, so this movie. The movie opens with a performance by Ellen Aim and the attackers in her old neighborhood. You meet, is it Billy Fish?
Something
is that his
Fish.
Name? Fish. You meet her manager Fish, who is Rick Moranis. Like within, he says one line. He's like, "This time we're in this shithole. We're not going to make any damn money." Like he's dressed like a doofus. Like fancy checkerboard shirt, like instantly you know who Fish is, you know what's going on.
Bow tie.
Yeah. You know he's a shithead. Ellen Aim, her songs in this movie were written by the Meatloaf guy. Did you know that, Slushy? Or like were you doing a bit when we were watching this?
No, I didn't know that.
For real?
Yeah, for real. That's funny.
Wow. So
I didn't know that until right now.
And I think Bonnie Tyler as well. But yeah, while we were watching this, Slushy was like, this is such a Meatloaf song. This is such a Bonnie Tyler song. Like all of Ellen Aim's songs in the movie are like they have that dramatic kind of ridiculousness that Meatloaf songs have. Like what's that lyric? Like there's an angel in the castle dancing like a cat on the stairs. Like what? Very Meatloaf.
Yeah,
it
no
fucking
kidding.
Rules. The songs in this movie are so goddamn good.
They're incredible. Some of the best ever. And like the cinematography on the performances is really great. It plays into the timelessness thing, you know, because she's very 80s and the music is very 80s and she's in this 50s zone, you know, and she doesn't want to be there. God, what is this? This is a good movie. What a good movie. I don't know.
Jim Steinman.
Steinman. Okay.
Yeah. And yes, he wrote for both Meatloaf and Bonnie Tyler.
And I was.
He wrote Total Eclipse of the Heart.
Yeah.
And he wrote I Would Do Anything for Love.
Yeah.
So it's like, yeah. Yes. That's really funny.
That is funny. Full disclosure, I was a little high watching this movie this time. Usually when I watch a movie high, I will either just spend the whole time like, this is so fucking perfect, which like Die Hard, I've done that with. And then like other times I will just forget a movie completely. Like I forget what the example. Someone was talking about something. Eliminators.
Yeah,
right.
Natasha, your movie.
Yeah, Charles Band's Eliminators. Just don't remember anything about that one. But yeah, so I feel like about the first half of this movie is like literally perfect. And I feel like after that it maybe goes off the rails a little bit, but I don't know. Does anyone agree with that?
I think it's good the entire time.
Yeah, I didn't say it's bad, but it's just
right.
I feel like the
I feel like
should we go? Go ahead, Slushy.
The trip home from rescuing her is maybe a little bit not as tight as the rest of it.
What were you gonna say, Count? Were you gonna say, should we say what the movie's about?
Yeah, should we say what the fucking movie's about?
Yeah,
we're not
probably
talking about the fuck the movie's about.
Yeah, so okay. We're here in the city zone. There's Ellen Aim, she's kidnapped by Willem Dafoe's motorcycle gang. And Raven. Yeah, Raven. Raven Shattuck. Great name. And a friend of hers has to call in her brother, Tom Cody, who was like Ellen's high school flame. How old are these characters supposed to be, by the way? Because I had never noticed, but one of the cops says he should be locked up like all the other juvenile delinquents. Right. Like, is he still 17?
I don't know.
He's,
well, he's got to be just making a crack at him, I guess.
Maybe. But
I always thought they were like in their late 20s.
Yeah.
That's what I took it as.
I don't know. Tom Cody.
When did this movie come out?
86?
84.
84. Okay.
Michael Praré would have been 26 at the time.
I mean, so sure. You know.
Maybe like 19, 20.
Yeah.
19 or 20.
So Cody basically has to go on a mission to rescue Ellen, and then the consequences of that. But yeah, like when the cinematography on like Raven's gang coming into the concert is so good, like they're in shadow and there's this huge backlight, like Willem Dafoe steps into the light. And then, as the chaos starts ensuing, Raven's gang, like, they're going after the cops. You know, they're not like, oh, shit, the cops, let's cheese it. They're just beating the shit out of the cop cars.
They fight back.
Just, yeah. You instantly know everything about, like, all the stakes are set up and all the characters and, like, how tough they are. Like, it's all so clear. Like, it just, it's great. You know, nobody watching this movie is going to be like, who's this guy? What's this guy doing? Why is he here?
What's his deal? What's his motivation?
Because the movie is just like, boom, look at this. Clear, crystal clear.
Dafoe isn't in it a lot, but you can tell from his brief role that this guy is going to be a fucking star because he just, the way he appears on screen, he's so fucking menacing.
Was this like his first role, one of them?
It's got to be an early role for him. He might have been Jesus before this.
What?
Said Jesus.
He played fucking Jesus in what's that movie called?
Not Jesus Christ Superstar.
Now, Last Temptation of Christ. That was 88. So this was before Jesus.
Okay.
He had his first leading role in the outlaw biker film The Loveless from 1982, then supporting roles in Streets of Fire, so it's like his second movie.
Big on the biker sixth role, I guess.
Sixth film.
Okay.
Looking at IMDb.
Okay,
sorry.
Thank
just
you.
Those are I like other films down.
Very tiny. Yes.
So Tom Cody, he's played by Michael Paré.
Michael Paré has been in a lot of Uwe Boll films.
Almost all of them, yes.
That's insane. No wonder he turned out the way he did. We'll talk about that later.
We've seen him on the podcast before. He was in the Puppet Master, The Littlest Reich, as the nasty police detective guy. But this is...
Oh, yeah. I completely forgot about that.
He's a young, hunky bad boy with kind of a slightly unfortunate, like, wispy beard going on. But, you know, you can look past it. So, I think that, like...
He's got a real good vagrant look.
Yeah. He's an ex-soldier. He's a tough guy. He's a fighter. He's a bad boy. He stops some punks. He steals their car. Again, you instantly know what he's up to. What kind of person he is. Like, the thing that I always compare other movies to this is the nighttime cinematography in this movie is like maybe the best ever.
It's very good.
Like all of the streets are wet and reflective. There's always like some kind of colored spotlight. If not multiple, like every nighttime shot, and there's a lot of them, it's most of the movie, is just like fucking great to look at.
A visual feast for your eyes, for your ears. The city looks lived in, even though it also looks like a set at the same time. It's such a weird balance to strike.
Yeah, it really does look like a soundstage, but it also...
It looks real. Yeah, it's weird. It's like a fairy tale. It's like... unlike anything you've ever seen in your life, Streets of Fire.
Often imitated, never duplicated.
Right. Yeah. I don't know what inspired this, is what I'd like to know. I don't know if they were going for the Broadway musical thing, but in a grounded Hollywood type setting.
Yeah, I don't know. It's for whatever reason, I guess it didn't work out, I guess.
Yeah, apparently they weren't ready for it.
Yeah. So I don't know. Fish, great. We haven't talked about McCoy. There's a lesbian soldier turns up and helps Tom Cody in his quest. There's a scene where a lady's stripping and McCoy is just like staring at the stripper. Like, not, you know, not explicitly lesbian, but certainly.
But she is very butch.
Yeah. And
Cody is not her type, she keeps saying.
Yeah, Cody's not her type. How could Cody not be someone's type? It's ridiculous. Well, I think here's from my notes. I feel like the scary bum scene could have been cut without anyone noticing.
Yeah, yeah, didn't probably add anything.
It's just kind of out of place, and
maybe shows how cowardly Fish really is if the audience didn't get it by now.
They would have had to, though.
I know, but people are stupid.
Moranis is great in this, by the way. There's a story that, like, sort of in a weird synchronicity way, I've seen, like, twice in the past couple weeks about how when they were getting ready to film this, Rick Moranis met Michael Pare and was like, "So are you really cool, or do you just act like it?" And apparently that made Michael Pare madder than, like, anything ever has. Like, it ruined his life or something. I don't know. Like, Christ, there's worse things to say to somebody.
Moranis is a comedian. Yeah. Okay?
He's like, I don't like working with comedians. They think they can say whatever they want to anybody. Like, there's people in my life who act like that, like, every time I meet them. I don't know.
I've heard worse.
Yeah.
Are you really cool, or just act like it?
Yeah. But I don't know. Moran, he plays a real asshole, just a little weaselly music promoter. Great
character. He's a promoter and also the new girlfriend, or new boyfriend to Ellen.
Right. Rival, and he's a great character. You know, Ellen, not it's weird, like, Ellen Aim as a damsel, like, was not really in that much danger, you know, like, they kidnapped her, they tied her up, they didn't assault her instantly. And then Willem Raven is like, "Let's come on, warm up to me. Let's fall in love for a few weeks, and then I'll let you go home." It's like, he's not like gonna kill her. I don't know. It's just kind of weird.
We don't know. I mean, he could be lying, of course.
He could be lying, but I don't think anyone in this movie is lying. I think you can take everything in this at face value.
Yeah, that's a good
point. More on that later. But I'm just looking at my notes. I don't know. Yeah, Slushy pointed out about the Western rifles. Like, I had never noticed that about the timeless aspect. They're using cowboy rifles. There's not,
yeah, they're very cool.
There's not like a lot of action in this movie. Like, nobody gets killed. Barely anyone even gets like beat up, but there's some shooting. And it's all like lever action cowboy rifles.
Lever action cowboy rifles, and then like a simple 12 gauge pump action shotgun.
This movie is style. It's pure style.
It's pure style, yes. I don't know. I don't really know. In general, like, I don't want to spoil the movie. I just want to say, watch this movie if you haven't seen it. And if you have, let us know what you think in the comments. I don't know.
You see, it's going to stick with you forever.
Yeah.
I feel like very often movie posters don't really capture the real mood of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I think with Streets of Fire, it very much does.
Yes. It's like, it's a great
perfectly
poster.
Encapsulate. Yeah. Everything about the film. You look at that poster and you know exactly what you're sitting down to watch.
Yeah.
Tonight is What It Means to Be Young, which is the closing song of the movie. We'll get into my head sometimes and end up having to listen to it like 5 times in a week, and then it'll disappear, and then it comes back a few months later. And because we've watched this, we've been wanting to watch this for a while, so I was already listening to all the songs before we watched it the other night, because I've just been listening to them over and over and over again. And since watching it, I keep listening to them over and over and over again. They just pump you up and make you feel really fucking good.
The soundtrack's interesting. Like, on one hand, you have Ellen and the big production, like, meatloafy songs, and then there's, like, the Rye Cooter sort of like honky tonk songs, which is all it's like, that's the music of the, what are they called? The Bombers.
Yeah.
Like, yes. Like the Rye Cooter honky tonk music is like, that's what the Bombers listen to. And then like the Straits over in the clean part of town listen to Ellen Aim. It's, I don't know. It's just, all the songs are great. Great music, great soundtrack. You feel it in the movie. Sticks with you. Slushy. It's your turn. I don't.
Yeah, I've been looking. This was not your first time seeing this, right, Slushy?
Right. Yeah. Mortis showed this to me whenever that happened. Time.
How did you feel?
I can never remember anything.
The first time you seen it, Slushy.
It was like, it's hard to describe when you're not super into film in general, and you watch a movie and you feel like you need to be into film as like someone who is interested in art. Like that is what this movie made me feel like.
That you need to be into film.
That as someone who is interested and cares about art as like a piece of culture and the human experience, I feel like, yeah, like this movie made me feel like I need to be paying attention to film more, because it is crazy how well it encapsulates like an idealized and yet very dark version of America. Mm-hmm. And like, obviously it's not a perfect image of it. There's a lot of parts of America that are not represented here, but it is also one of those things where it's like this, I feel like this film is a great time capsule for American culture in a lot of, you know, like the action movie romance in, you know, kind of a narrow viewpoint of romance, but still romance. like the clash between like money makers in a derogatory sense and regular people.
Right.
The shit that, like, it is also a pretty good showcase for how war affects a person. Two people in particular.
More on that later. And...
McCoy. Okay.
Yeah. I feel like this is a movie that people who care about filmmaking need to watch. And I feel like it's a fucking, like, truly, truly a shame that it is not considered a must watch for people who are into film. And it's truly a shame that it, like, did poorly in the box office. This came out the same day as Star Trek III and made 1/10 of what Star Trek III made.
Which one is three?
Search for Spock.
The Search for Spock.
Yeah.
Not a good one.
Yeah.
And, well, like, yes, Star Trek is, like, obviously people watch Star Trek III because it's, like, you know, the one after Wrath of Khan. And also it's Star Trek. People know about Star Trek. But, like, Jesus Christ. Why did this movie get so ignored in the time that it came out?
This is the movie to show your college friends. This is it. This is the quintessential movie to show your fucking college film buddies or anyone to impress people with.
Listen, we started saying this. Understand, we started saying this as a little laugh, and then it became a bit, and then it became a bit of a bit, but this is for real.
This is for real, for real. Like, this is the movie.
Yeah.
To show your buddies.
Yeah, like, this is, I feel like this is a movie that if you love movies, if you love films, and you're not, like, you know, not on the level of, like, oh, I have all the Criterion releases, of course, and I've seen The Seventh Seal 7 times, at least, yes. Like, if you're not that kind of movie person, like,
it's a good movie, though.
If you just... I mean, yes, it is. I've seen all the works of Ingmar Bergman. Like, if you just like movies, you know, it's a great movie.
It really is.
It's a great film. It's a great movie. It's not highfalutin at all, but it's really good. Yeah.
You know, some people might say I'm pretentious. I've heard it. I've heard the rumors. Okay? Streets of Fire warms my heart.
Let me just say, Count, let me do my bit. You mentioned tonight is what it means to be young. So here's... The last couple times I've watched this, I've come to grips with something. I'm bisexual, right? I've always had trouble with male attraction because I came up when I did in Central Kansas. You know, it's not normal to be attracted to men, right? It's always been difficult for me. Over the course of this movie, I fall in love with Tom Cody. And when he leaves at the end, I fucking cry. I don't know, like, how else to explain it. What a great character. And, you know, you can attach to different parts of that, as we'll talk about later.
He looks so fucking sad when he leaves.
He does.
I think he is.
I know.
But he feels like he needs to.
He doesn't feel like he knows guitars.
Yeah.
I have, can I, I've been reading a little bit about the film on Wikipedia.
Yeah.
And I,
it's
I
good. Wanna... It's good to have an ADD person who can do research during the podcast.
I want to, just read a little excerpt here.
Yeah.
48 hours. Mm-hmm. Walter Hill's film prior to this. He directed that. The producers were Larry Gordon and Joel Silver and screenwriter Larry Grosse. Larry Grosse published a diary that he was keeping during the shooting of 48 hours. And
was that after this or before or simultaneous?
It doesn't say when he published it, okay. But he was writing it while they were working on 48 hours. And there was an entry dated 12th of August, 1982.
Oh, okay.
A night before filming 48 hours began. And this is that entry. Again, this is written by Larry Grosse, screenwriter. Walter presents me with a page of notes he's prepared for a new script. It will be the first in a series of adventures of an action hero he's had it in his mind to create for a long time. The character's name is Tom Cody. And Walter has it in his head to create a franchise about him, introducing him as the Stranger. He asks me if I'm interested in writing the script with him. I ask him, is the Pope Catholic? Larry and Joel Silver would be along on this ride. Suits me. I feel like this guy writes characters the way he writes himself. And that's, I just found that really interesting.
I wish we got more.
Yeah.
Wait. Hold on.
And I also figured that would be a great segue into the sequel to Streets of Fire.
I wish we got more.
Hang on. I want to do my. I have a little presentation prepared.
Don't monkey paw me.
Okay. We're doing it now.
On the influences of Streets of Fire. So I mentioned I discovered Streets of Fire. Some dumbass blog on some internet. Oh, Final Fight. The 1989 Capcom game is based on Streets of Fire. That's how I discovered the movie. Well, here's some comparisons. You have Tom Cody. If this is mainly for the video viewers, I guess, but you have Tom Cody in Streets of Fire and Cody Travers in Final Fight, arguably the main character. They're both named Cody. That's kind of the whole thing there.
I think the characterization of Cody from Final Fight and later Street Fighter is pretty similar as well.
That, yes. Can we come back to that?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. So there is...
I was worried you were just going to leave it.
No. There's one scene in the movie where Tom Cody wears suspenders and sort of like olive dress pants, and it's a little bit like Mayor Mike Hagar from Final Fight. It's, you know, a little bit. The first enemy that you encounter in Final Fight is dressed Willem Dafoe is in one scene of Streets of Fire. The enemy named
Japanese get away with this.
The enemy named Bread. He just has the same weird like vinyl. What are these called? Like
vinyl overalls that go up to his nipples.
Yeah.
Waiters, I guess.
Yeah. It's like a really strange outfit. Cody leave at end. Last, you know, in both at the end of Final Fight, Cody has rescued his beloved Jessica and he walks away at the end of Streets of Fire. Cody has rescued Ellen Aim, and he walks away. On that note...
Does that mean Guy is McCoy?
You know? That's a good question. I always... ever since I found out about the ending to Final Fight, like, okay, Cody's walking away, and then Jessica comes up, and she's like, Cody, wait. Guy jumps over Cody and punches him and knocks him down. I've always thought that was very strange in the... I realized today, maybe Guy did that so that Cody had to stop and talk to Jessica. You know? I always thought it was kind of... I always thought it was like, why is this ninja beating up his friend? What's going on here? But,
that makes sense.
Yeah. Similar character arc. Not much other similarities. As we said, you know, there's almost no fisticuffs in this movie, but, almost all of the action in Streets of Fire is gun-based. No guns in Final Fight. So really, you know, if you come to this from the Final Fight angle, it's like, maybe you're going to want more punching.
Don't expect a Final Fight movie.
Right. That's Brain Smasher.
That is Brain Smasher.
which we talked about last week. But, yeah, Slushy, I guess we can talk about that now. So, after Final Fight, Cody is sort of portrayed in a certain way. Like, in Final Fight, it's like Tom Cody. He's like honorable, you know, he wants to go fight injustice. And then when he appears later in the Capcom universe, he's in jail because he has some kind of mental disorder where he is unable to stop fighting. Which, you know, it would be weird if you were to think that same thing about Tom Cody and then make a movie about it 28 years later. But, you know, that would be pretty weird. Some other...
Well, the main difference is
that
Cody Travers from Final Fight wants to be in jail, keeps himself in jail, and has shown many times that if something happens and he feels like he needs to leave jail, he just can.
Well, if you check Time at Story FAQ, Cody is actually the strongest
character in the entire universe.
He is canonically the strongest.
That's why he wears his very long handcuffs when he fights. Because otherwise he's worried he would kill somebody. Just
he's stronger
the same
than
reason
M. Bison?
Why.
Yep.
Stronger, way stronger. He could defeat M. Bison with
M. Bison's only his tough. Pinky.
Nope.
No, he could do it. Cody's. Even Oro, who keeps one arm bound while fighting just so that the other fighter has a chance, could not stand up to Cody Travers, now mayor of Metro City.
So, some other,
I don't really know
some
what,
of the other
the
things I've got here
behind that.
There's a Dirty Pair calendar, famous anime Dirty Pair. There's just an image in a calendar that the girls are dressed as Streets of Fire. So that's on the. Really no other connecting tissue there.
So Japan loves this movie.
Japan does love
they
this
fucking,
movie.
Yeah, they absolutely love this movie.
Another thing, if you've ever seen Bubblegum Crisis, famous cyberpunk anime, basically the opening scene of Bubblegum Crisis is the opening scene of Streets of Fire, like a 80s music performance with a lot of like very similar cinematography. And then cut to like motorcycle based violence back and forth. It's not exactly the same, but very, very similar. Another influence is the Proto Men, which I don't count brought this up. I've seen this image, the album cover, which is just the Streets of Fire poster. What is going on here, you two?
Yeah, I'd like
so to that's Dr. Light holding his wife who got killed by one of the robots that Light built, and that's Wily on the screen, who's become kind of a 1984 style big brother in the city, and has framed Dr. Light by making his robot go rampant and kill his wife. This is all explained primarily in that album, the one
the Father
song
of Death.
Yeah, there's one song in particular that kind of goes over that, but I can't remember what it's called right now.
So the Proto Man is not Proto Man, of course, is a Mega Man character, the video game Mega Man. I've always assumed the Proto Man was a video game cover band, but I've learned today that they're not. They just they write original songs about video games.
Yeah, well, just about Mega Man.
Yeah,
only about Mega Man.
Only about Mega Man.
They did have a cover album.
Yeah,
of 80s covers
of Queen.
All Queen?
Was it All Queen?
It's All Queen.
Maybe they had another one that was.
This came out in 2009. I wanted to correct myself. September 2009, because I kept saying 2008. So I didn't know about Streets of Fire until 2009. It was like this album came out and was posted fucking everywhere on the net. All the nerds were going apeshit for it, and it's amazing. And I do like it. And then they were like, "Oh, it's based on Streets of Fire." So I ended up watching Streets of Fire my first semester
of
college.
Has Act 3 come out yet?
It's never coming out. No, it didn't come out. Valve count to three. Slushy?
Neither can the Proto Man.
Neither can the Proto Man.
Proto Man, not Valve. Believe it or not.
They've released a couple of songs from Act 3, but they just haven't released that.
If you're gonna do a long-term project, you gotta be able to finish it.
Well, the first album was 2005. That was Act 1. Act 2, 2009. Act 3 hasn't happened.
Are they still together?
They're still together. They put out a live album in 2020. That might be the covers that Slushy is talking about. But they did one in 2012, which was A Night of Queen, and it's all Queen.
I'm talking about the cover-up.
Yeah.
So just some of the influences of Streets of Fire. And we've talked about in previous episodes, we've talked about Radioactive Dreams, apparently influenced by Streets of Fire. Brain Smasher, probably influenced by Streets of Fire. Another film by Albert Pyun, influenced by Streets of Fire, is Road to Hell.
Oh boy.
Road to Hell came out in 2012. I'm seeing it won some awards here. This is a
best picture.
So this is confusing, and I'm wondering what version we watched, because
Do
you think it would really matter?
Are there multiple versions?
Under the release section of its Wikipedia, this is a movie that's hard to do any.
We watched the DVD.
Okay.
Whatever's on the DVD.
This is a movie that's kind of difficult to do research about because nobody knows anything about it.
Right.
Or why it exists, other than maybe Michael Paré is insane and Albert Pyun just likes making movies. But the release section says the film had its world premiere at the Alamo Drafthouse Cinema in Austin, Texas in October 2008. The Chicago premiere of Road to Hell was at the Patio Theater in March 9th of 2013. In November 2013, additional shooting was done with singer Joey Falco from ABC's reality television show Wife Swap.
Do you think that's like the guy? Is that the guy who interviews her? Like, who is that the radio guy, maybe? Like, I can't think of who that would have been. Yeah, unless we didn't see that version.
He is listed as Gabriel the Archangel.
Oh, well, that's a lady. That Gabriel's the lady.
The woman on the road.
Okay.
Okay.
So we watched the full version.
Oh, so that shit.
And it's shit.
All right. Okay. I guess that explains why her name is spelled Joei.
Right.
Which is not a way.
So getting ahead of ourselves here. This movie fucking sucks ass.
It sucks.
Paul. I'd rather watch the Avengers again.
This is it's a sequel. This is Road. This is Streets of Fire 2. In the mind of Albert Pyun and his wife, who wrote the fan fiction that this is based on, and apparently Michael Paré, who is in it, and I guess like funded it in part.
Yeah, maybe. Like, Pune states that the genesis of Road to Hell began when he and Paré attended a film festival in Spain.
And they're just like,
is what
talking
Wikipedia
about it
says. I guess so. Yeah.
So what a strange thing. Like this, if you're looking at the video, you can see this movie has all those little olive branch things that are always, you always see them on the cover of a movie. And you know, that's how it's good and smart. I have no idea. Yellow Fever, Belfast 2012, Polygrind Underground Film Festival, 13 Costa del Sol Fantasy Film Festival, like Best Actor. Like, it has all these awards. I do not understand, like, what else was at these festivals? Anything? Like, was this the only thing at these festivals? Because this
might have been.
This is truly.
It might not even be real.
This is horrible. This is a horrible film, and I know we've been talking up Pyun, and
I've looked at a couple of lists of like debuts and premieres from these festivals, and multiple Pyun films at multiple of the festivals at the years when Road to Hell was given awards. So like, I just don't know.
I would morbid curiosity about what those other movies would be and how they are, because this is worse than the worst Puppet Master that isn't a clip show.
This is worse than the Avengers.
This is worse than the Avengers.
This is
what the Risey should cover.
Right. Like we've been making a lot of little snide comments this episode. They're all directed at this film.
Right, because it's a fucking. I haven't seen a film this bad in a very, very long time.
It's mind-boggling. Like this, it is
it's barely a movie.
It is a Road to Hell. I keep saying Road to Hell. It is a Streets of Fire sequel. It has the names filed off, like. For, I guess, probably rights reasons, although I feel like you could probably just have him be named the same thing. But, like, Tom Cody is named Cody Wilson, but everyone just calls him Cody. And most of this stuff we only learn from a text crawl, like, which, like, right. Why even have the text crawl in the movies and tell us that they have different names if, like, you're just, maybe that's the legal covering of ass, but... Like Ellen Aim is Ellen Target. But then there's other like Fish and Raven get mentioned, and like nobody, you know.
Fish paid Raven to kill Ellen.
This
Aim.
I don't because understand.
Ellen Dream is also in this, and that's his daughter.
Yes. So, so okay. The synopsis of this film is that two ladies, two hookers, strippers, I don't know, both. They're
two lesbians.
They have done a, what's that movie? They have done like a Natural Born Killers style spree murder of like everybody at a strip club. And now they're fleeing across the desert. Highway 666. And so is Tom Cody. Tom Cody is trying to go on Highway 666 to get to Edge City, which is, we find out where Streets of Fire took place. They named it.
And they're
it
all
now.
Listening to 66.6 AM.
Yeah.
And also, the highways are evil, or the highways are...
Right.
Not really explained. I don't know.
Like, the first thing in the film is there's this just text on the screen that's like, People don't take fucking roads anymore. There used to be angels on the roads. Now all the angels are fucking whores, and people just take fucking highways now. And it's this quote is attributed to Cody Wilson. It's like I guess somebody was just like really proud of that line, and they couldn't fit it into the movie, so they put it at the start of the movie.
I wanted to say something about this, and this is coming from me.
Yeah,
okay?
Coming from
this
you.
This movie is like extremely misogynistic. Like a really bad way.
Right. Yeah. I said
like in a very actual way.
So But and this is written by Albert Pune's wife. I forget the name off the top of my head. I said while we were watching Streets of Fire, there's a point in Streets of Fire where Tom Cody knocks out Ellen Aim, so he can go have a fight, you know, without her getting in the way. You know, that's
right.
Obviously, these days that wouldn't fly. Couldn't put that in a movie unless it's Versus, another one of my top 10 movies. What does that say about me? I don't know. I'll live with it, but. I said while we were watching Streets of Fire, Road to Hell is the movie you make if that's the part of Streets of Fire that turns you on. Is him knocking her out.
Right, that's a little bit that they glimpsed.
It's like, if that's the thing you pulled from Streets of Fire, that's like, oh, Tom Cody's awesome. Like, this is so horrible. It's so. Like, he encounters these women, and he just, like, continues. It's established immediately, like, oh, they're murderers, and they're horrible people, whatever. I guess that's supposed to make it okay, and he's like, you whores, you bitches, and he's, like, constantly just clocking them in the nose.
Just beating the shit out of them until they're bleeding and like, crying.
And, like, for no apparent reason, so... And then the other thing is, like, Tom Cody's car breaks down, and he has McCoy's corpse in his trunk, which he has cut the eyes out of and carved the word Ellen on her chest. Like, so like this, okay.
He's like a super soldier.
While we were watching this film, I was like genuinely like trying to get anything out of it. I was trying so hard. Like, I was trying so hard to just figure out what the fuck I was watching and why it exists, and I couldn't get anything out of it. I had to go smoke a Swisher Sweet. I don't think a movie has ever made me this angry. Just as like, what a weird disappointment.
Right. People talk about the Star Wars prequels ruining Star Wars, or the sequels ruining Star Wars. This doesn't ruin Streets of Hell, but it's such a fucking disappointment. Like, it is. Like, you fucking nerds know nothing. Watch Streets of Fire and then watch Road to Hell, okay?
And it's weirder because Albert Pune is, like, obviously big into Streets of Fire and, like,
right,
on some level really gets it. And then he makes this, and it's. I don't know. He said there were all these interviews on. There was one interview on the DVD that said with Pune, like, in the lobby of the film festival or something, and he said, like, yeah, you know, Michael's had a hard 28 years since Streets of Fire. Like, in a lot of ways, this is about that hard 28 years. This movie is really meaningful to him. Like. What? I don't get it. Like, he's never stopped working. He's never been in great movies since Streets of Fire, but like,
he says, like, this is not a sequel. I just want to see what he's been up to 28 years later.
It's like, right. Like, it's so the energy of this is like fucking, it's like a Todd McFarlane, like, I said this earlier, like Cinderella 2, like what if Cinderella was a fucking leather dominatrix, and then like Little Miss Muffet had like a real, like a monster spider, you know, like it.
Right.
It's like, no, you're missing the point.
Also, nothing. He just spends the movie beating the shit out of two women, and it's constantly cutting into songs on the radio, constantly cutting to some. Gabriel the Angel on the Road, and nothing fucking else happens.
Right.
It's all exposition, like, told you. You know, show, don't tell? This is all fucking tell. Like, the entire movie is just being told to you shittily.
Like, the thing I was trying to reconcile, like, so, okay, Cody, he spends the movie beating up these spree-killing women in the highway. So this movie is all green screened, and they don't have a steady camera, so like the foreground is kind of shaking a lot of times, but then the green screen is not shaking. Like, this movie looks like shit. There's like a yellow filter over everything. The contrast is all blown out. Like, the thing that I was trying to reconcile, like, it's okay, you have this Archangel Gabriel lady, like, speaking to the audience about how she's trying to save Cody's soul, and like, the movie, it seems they're on Highway 666, and the Archangel, like, the movie has told you several times that it's literally purgatory, but at the same time, it's like, he's going somewhere, like,
it's going nowhere fast.
It's going nowhere fast. There's so many little, like, lines from Streets of Fire that are just thrown in, like, a cute way. It's so...
You think, did he watch the original movie and, you know, a boy will be the next best thing, next thing to an angel, and they took it literally as angels are around?
It's...
like, what the fuck?
It's very... like, it's going for symbolism, but it's also... literal. It seems to also be literal. It's so frustrating on like that level. Like he killed McCoy, you know.
McCoy.
He killed McCoy, his friend, his good soldier friend from the movie, and like, I don't know, it's an incredibly frustrating film.
I could give you a little insight,
and then at the end of the film, sorry.
No, go ahead.
At the end of the film, he finally meets up with his daughter, and he's like, hey, I'm gonna be a dad again, and then like that's how the movie ends. Like what? Never mind that he's killed a bunch of women like right. that day, and then like like, I know it's a symbolism and it's purgatory, but also I guess he probably literally killed those people, and he has been killing people. But like, he's decided to be a dad now. It I don't know. It doesn't make any sense. It's very frustrating.
I don't understand his motivation, because the movie makes it clear that Ellen was killed years ago, and he only finds out at the end of the movie. So he thought Ellen was alive this entire time. Like, what the fuck is like? I don't right. know. I don't know why he's going back to town then. It doesn't make any fucking sense.
I mean, it's like he's had a hard time, and he's going through hell to get home. Like, it's on paper it makes sense to me, right? But like,
it makes sense if it was like, hey, Ellen wants you to see her or something, but I don't know.
I like, at the core of the movie, he's a father who has never connected with a daughter who maybe he only learned about from the radio.
Probably want to fucking kill her.
That's what it seems like, right? For most of the movie, it seems like he's trying to get to her to kill her. And like, these other women that he meets, like, assume that's what he wants. And he's like, no, like it seems like it's trying to do a symbolism, but it's hard to do a symbolism. It's when when you're doing a fanfic about a character who's killed other characters from the original movie. It's like, it's so strange. I can't reconcile it. I don't know. What were you gonna say, Slushy?
Both Albert Pune and his wife, what was her name? Cynthia Kernan, were interviewed about Road to Hell.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll link these later so you guys can read them, because they are pretty insightful. But basically, like, Cynthia Kernan, who, you know, you mentioned was the screenwriter for this, believes that Cody, like, at the end of Streets of Fire, Cody knows that Ellen's life is going to be, you know, she's going to be this huge star, and he isn't going to fit into that.
Yeah.
And that's why he leaves. because he understands that it wouldn't be a good relationship for either of them, which is why he says, you know, I'm not the kind of guy to carry guitars.
Yeah.
Albert Pune, on the other hand, says that Ellen only cares about her. I'll just read his exact words. The real Ellen was too shallow and sour. She couldn't be bothered with the feelings of other people. She never thanked McCoy for saving her. She exploited Fish when she kissed him to hurt Cody. Cody was all about Ellen, and Ellen was all about Ellen. He let her go so she could fulfill herself. Even when she said she'd leave it for all, or leave it all for him, it was to get what she wanted, but she would eventually have thrown or driven him away. For someone like Ellen, the unavailable is more attractive than the available. I don't understand where the fuck he's getting any of that.
Hmm. I don't like, disagree. You can read media however you want. That's
yeah, for sure. But also, I don't understand why Cynthia Kernan, who seems to idolize Cody as like a man's man who understands emotions, would become this horrible, bloody murderer who loves to torture women.
Right. I mean, there's the
it's
reminded me of the line from Streets of Fire where McCoy is like, some people don't talk about their feelings because they don't have them. Other people don't talk about their feelings because they got them more than anyone.
Yeah.
You know,
great line.
It is.
It,
which one? Watched, which one did you make a movie about?
Right. When we watched Streets of Fire, which we watched after this, I was just thinking, like, that whole opening scene is an entire better movie than obviously Road to Hell is. Just like that one little fucking opening song. It's like, this is incredible, and Road to Hell captures none of this.
So on the context, I don't know what I'm trying to say. On the note of Road to Hell connecting to Streets of Fire, we find out once Cody reaches Edge City and finally reaches his daughter and his sister, same actor in both movies. She's in both movies too.
But they brought her back.
She lets us know that Fish had Raven kill Ellen. So that's how Ellen died, is Rick Moranis had Willem Dafoe paid him to kill her.
It's so. Just weird because, like, Fish wouldn't want to do that for emotional reasons or monetary reasons, and I don't think Raven would want to do that.
Right, which...
Yeah, it doesn't make sense,
like, for he's not party he, to be he's involved. Not a killer, Raven. You never get the impression that he's a killer.
That's the thing with, like, Streets of Fire, is everybody goes so hard out of their way to make sure they don't fucking kill anyone.
Yeah.
And then they're just killing people constantly in Road to Hell.
Like,
in fucking brutal ways.
And that's part of brutal the ways. Yes. That's like part of the problem I have with, like, reconciling the symbolism with the literal is, like, by the once he gets to Edge City and is reunited with his daughter, like, we're back in the real world, right? But, like, no. The real world of the movie is still, like, a horrible place, and everyone's horrible. So, like, was anything fake? I don't know. And then at the very end of the movie, there's one final screen of text that says that night Cody caught his fish and gutted him, but he was disappointed to find that Raven had already been killed by his daughter and the name. And it turns out Raven's daughter was one of the two murderer women that he ran into on the road. So just like a really,
we were talking about a lot of tight scripts. Yeah. This episode, this is not one of them.
I mean, I would be surprised if there really was much of a script, but
right.
I don't know. How do you get here from Streets of Fire? Like, it's a bad like follow-up tonally. It's a bad follow-up story-wise. You know, it just I don't know. And it one of the best music-driven movies of the year. Most of the songs in the film are just Streets of Fire songs. Like there's
right.
There's two covers of Ellen Ames songs, and then there's like one or two other songs that like
and they fucking suck. They're not good.
They're not great. They're not great. But
I don't want to insult the musicians. I know they, you know, God bless you, but
the covers are fine. Like I don't feel like they're, you know,
I thought they were kind of lackluster in comparison.
Well, yeah.
Like if you're going to do it, if you're,
I think for a zero budget, like small band covering.
Okay. That's
such a like overblown musical production. Like it's fine. They right, do a fine like, job, but like,
it's not their fault. Yeah. I would say. So I do apologize and I retract that. Cause I'm realizing now it's not their, like they were hired to do it and they did it fine for what they were paid to do. But just as a follow up to Streets of Fire, it just seems like a.
I would say, don't see this. Like just
stay far away from it. Not
as a curiosity. Maybe if you're like a fucking film student or something, and you want to write a paper on it or something, maybe you could do that.
Someone's gotta track down Michael Pare and fucking just ask him about this.
It's weird, you know? Even just as a metaphor about 28 hard years in Hollywood, I just don't get it.
Right, did he want to Michael Pare wanna fucking kill women? Like, dude, what are you trying to tell me?
Weird movie, bad movie.
One of the worst. This is truly one of the worst movies.
And we've,
especially in comparison to the first,
we've been on such an Albert Pyun kick these last episodes. We've been loving his work. Jumped ahead a few years. what a disappointment. I don't know.
Yeah.
Anything else, Slushy?
Michael Pare was apparently not involved with the writing of Road to Hell at all, according to Cynthia Kernan.
Well, yeah.
And she also says,
because it's her,
that yeah,
it's her.
She also says the new Tom Cody is. I want to get the exact line here because it's ridiculous. Michael Pare's performance is astonishing, much darker, more nuanced, and mature than Tom Cody's character from Streets of Fire. He's less pretty, more handsome, and sexier because he's more dangerous.
Who's saying this?
I think this Cynthia Kernan is saying that.
Oh, well.
The lady who wrote the film, and I think maybe she just is really into some weird shit. No kink shaming, but get a grip, lady. Jesus Christ.
They ruined Luke Skywalker. He threw away the lightsaber. Why would he do that? They just bastardized his whole character. He would never behave like this. Watch Road to Hell. Okay? That's
don't watch Road to Hell. Ignorance is bliss.
To hell too.
Enjoy your little bubble. It's okay.
If you fucking hate the Star Wars sequels, watch Streets of Fire, then Road to Hell. That's who it's for.
Okay. I love it. It's good.
Well, all the people that hate the Star Wars sequels, not all, a lot of the very vocal people that hate the Star Wars sequels really just hate women, so maybe they'll love Road to Hell.
You'll love Road to Hell. If you hate women, you'll love Road to Hell. That should be on the fucking poster. A misogynist's wet dream.
Here's another thing from Road to Hell is in Streets of Fire, you know, Cody is like an ex-soldier. He's like, he served for what must have been not very long. And all he says about it is like, I liked shooting the guns.
Right.
In Road to Hell, the Archangel Gabriel speaks to the screen and is like, Tom Cody was mutated by the government program into the most elite killer of all time. He went on missions and killed so many people on his missions, and he was so good at it, and that's what he's still doing. He's still killing people all the time, constantly, and it's all that he does, and it's all that he knows, because that's what the government did to him.
This is like if the Sonic OC people on DeviantArt back in the day got to make a movie about their edgy character. I'm sure it still happens, right?
The Sonic OCs aren't as edgy anymore.
Well, they used to be, you know, 2002, yeah, 2003. Sure. Like, those people, if they got their hands on a camera and a green screen.
Bad movie. Don't watch it. Watch Streets of Fire. Watch Gross Point Blank. Only Lovers. Seems good. I don't know.
Yeah, watch Only Lovers. Watch The Love Witch. I think Road to Hell is the only one I can't recommend this week.
And here's what else you can do. You can listen to the podcast on Spotify, Apple Music, we think, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts. I don't know. What's the other one?
YouTube, Spotify, Google, Apple,
Spotify. YouTube. Leave a review. It really helps us. I've heard people say this a lot. Well, I don't know.
Engagement.
I don't
Thumbs
know what
helps.
It means. Yeah.
Thank Anything you so else? Much for listening. Have a happy October.
Yeah, we're gonna be trying to figure out. Slushy's going to Sweden. We're gonna be in flux a little bit, but we're gonna figure out a schedule. We'll be back. We're gonna.
You don't
watch
hear
movies.
From us. It's not nothing you did.
Well, the Let's Kill Count episode will be before I leave for Sweden. Yeah.
Boy,
I thought we were doing that after.
That's really moving the schedule up on it, huh?
Because I got wedding shit, Slushy.
All right. Maybe.
And Halloween, we got to do horror movies.
Yeah, we got to do horror.
We got to watch horror movies.
Horror in October.
Here's a horror movie, Road to Hell.
Yeah. Start off your Spooktober with that. Put away the Hocus Pocus.
Hey, what were they playing at the Halloween party? Road to Hell. I got to see
it. Wasn't any good. It was horrible.
A hateful lesbian cut off her partner's head and stick it on her Jeep like a fucking hood ornament. Horrible, horrible film. Anyway, that's all.
Bye.
Say goodnight, Slushy.
Goodnight, Slushy.